actually, before I start, actually, it's really hard to see. But how many, are there any entrepreneurs in the audience? Show of hands. Oh, wow. Wow. That's kind of almost half the audience. Any investors? That's a brave man right there. So all you other guys, here he is. Right. Yeah. Should see the size of his pocketbook. And we did the American, and any and mindfulness practitioners? And again, about half. Any fans of the new U2 album? One. Tim Cook has something very special for you. So I live in the world of entrepreneurial talent. As she said, I'm an angel investor. My children love the fact that anybody would call me an angel in any sense of the word. I love doing it. I'm fascinated by entrepreneurs and passionate about helping them. Entrepreneurs set out to sort of reshape the universe, which sounds super grand, but they do stuff every day that statistically has an 80% chance of failure. But when they do succeed, as you know, people like Larry and Sergey here have shown us at Google, amazing stuff happens. They create, you know, disruptive new products and services. They create meaningful jobs. They can help drive economic growth. It's a big deal, and it's very, very exciting. The common misperception about entrepreneurs is that it's all about the idea. It's actually very rarely about the idea. It's actually always about execution. It's always about getting stuff done. So these people are doers. And as we know, you know, doers often need help to just be. I think we heard a bit about that just recently. So let me start sort of top down, and then I'll give you some bottom-up examples. Top down, in Europe, it's not super clear font, but basically the gist is the size of the balls. The venture capital investment in the US is about 5 to 1 bigger than it is in Europe, and the markets are roughly the same size, populations roughly the same size. So that provides, for the demand side of entrepreneurial talent, it provides, you know, something of a challenge. Actually, interestingly, the Europe bit is growing at about 20% per annum, according to Ernst & Young, and the US bit is kind of flat. So there is some redress happening, but, you know, there's a disadvantage there. The even bigger challenge I think a lot of us are beginning to recognize is actually on the supply side. So it is, where are the European equivalents of Mark Zuckerberg, Larry and Sergey, you know, Steve Jobs, Bill Gates? And actually, they are out there. But the more concrete question is, how do we embolden more young Europeans to embark upon a more entrepreneurial path through their professional lives? And then more specifically, how to help them develop the requisite skills to do that. And those, we might talk about the hard, I kind of hate the hard soft thing, but the hard skills of entrepreneurship around coding, design, user interface, finance, all the kind of super hard stuff. And then what we might call the soft stuff, you know, basically how do we help entrepreneurs to be happy, healthy, and peaceful. And in an entrepreneurial context, here's what we find, that the great entrepreneurs, I've been lucky enough to work with thousands of them, they are cheerful, optimistic, positive, you know, high energy, decisive, all that stuff. We'll come back to personal exceptionalism in a second. It's kind of an interesting concept. They are also great entrepreneurs. They're highly resilient, and they're great at making decisions in highly ambiguous, highly volatile situations. And again, we'll come back to this notion of anti-fragile in a second. I'm intrigued if people have come across that before. And, you know, they also, great entrepreneurs, do know how to manage the stress and anxiety that's kind of inevitable in what they do. And again, we'll come back to the emotional intelligence piece in a second. So what I'll do, so that's the kind of top-down challenge. This is something that I'm passionate about. And then I'll talk you through some of the kind of bottom-up initiatives that I've seen. And actually, I would love, if we've got time for questions and, you know, Q&A afterwards, I'd love to hear about anything you guys have, you know, heard about as well. One of my favorite groups is based in London, called Entrepreneur First. I have a hideous bias here. My 22-year-old daughter is the program director at Entrepreneur First, right? So there's my bias revealed. And the two people who originally started it are just awesome. Ex-McKinsey. We have helped them over the last few years, we being the royal we, Mark Williams, actually people who actually know what they're talking about, Mark Williams and Felicia Huppert and Mindfulness in Schools, Chris and Richard. And they have provided, Entrepreneur First have provided for their participants, and their participants are top graduates from top, at the moment, British universities, soon to be European universities, who are entrepreneurially inclined. And this is a bit modeled upon Teach First, where, you know, before you jump into McKinsey or Goldman Sachs or BCG or some of those companies, you know, you might want to do a year of teaching first. This is somewhat modeled upon that. So these are graduates, often computer science graduates, but not necessarily. And they are entrepreneurially inclined in some way. They probably don't have an idea, and they probably don't have a team. But they turn up at this, and they are very, very bright. They've distinguished themselves at top universities. So these people are given, throughout their year, it's a one-year thing, they're given lots of opportunities to do voluntary mindfulness sessions hosted by and run by people that we've probably all heard of in this room. And they get a 50% voluntary participation rate. And what apparently is really interesting is that they, Entrepreneur First, observe that a lot of the individuals actually meditate or have some kind of contemplative practice anyway, but the fact that they then put it on, and it kind of legitimizes it, and more people turn up, and they feel emboldened by the fact that, oh, wow, it turns out that, you know, half the class do this, and I thought I was the only one. So it has, you know, it has value in that respect. They've now started to extend that into what they call pastoral life chats. So these are 20-minute chats once a week, if you want it, if you feel like you need it. And they're actually now, at the end of this year, going to hire a full-time psychologist, a coach, because of all the reasons we just talked about. These young people are sort of thrown into a pressure cooker environment. I mentioned personal exceptionalism earlier, and I've never heard the phrase before until I was talking to the Entrepreneur First guys, and they did some analysis of profiling their cohort using this guy Michael Deering from Stanford. I think it's brilliantly written, who's done work on the 5 cognitive distortions, which sounds nice, doesn't it, of people who get stuff done. And personal exceptionalism is the biggest determinant that Entrepreneurs First have found of success on the program. And that is this macro sense. I don't know how many people in this room can identify this, but a macro sense that you're in the top of your cohort, your work is snowflake special, which I love, or that you are destined to have experiences, you know, outside the norm. Actually, how many people feel that they embody personal exceptionalism? There's one brave, so yo, here we go. Actually, not the investor guy. His hand is firmly down. So. And not the U2 fan, oddly enough. This stuff is kind of fascinating. Several people in this room, is Chris here? Chris Run? Yay, hello, Chris. And Tessa, you know Roland. So this company is a company called Roly. It's 50 incredibly, exceptionally talented individuals, all very young. And they are building a next generation keyboard. And it's hardware design, software design, and elite musicians all in one actually very cool office space in East London. And Roland Lam, the CEO, is a Zen Buddhist. He was trained in Zen Buddhism in Japan. He's still only about 31, so he did that. He then did a degree in Sanskrit and Chinese philosophy at Harvard, and then he won a scholarship to the Royal College of Art to do design, and designed the early prototype of this beautiful new keyboard. He's just one of those exceptional individuals that, you know, we're lucky enough to bump into sometimes. Corey, the COO, is very experienced in dance, yoga, and emergency medicine, which I always find a pretty formidable combination. And Jordan Rodess, who's head of music, has a beard down to about here. Awesome-looking guy. Music Radar just voted him the best keyboard player ever, which is probably a contentious title. But so they have. So you imagine when you've got people like that running a company, they've tried to institutionalize work practices that embody mindfulness, and those manifest in many ways. So the first thing in the morning, I'm an investor there. I'm there quite a lot. They have a session, a 10-minute session, the morning meeting, what's going on today, and they make room in that for appreciations. And so they'll go around the room, and, you know, again, on an entirely voluntary basis, you're not forced to appreciate people that you work with, but it's nice if you feel that you want to, and that's encouraged. Then they'll have a 10-minute session, which is, I can't remember what they call it, but it's kind of it's tidying up, basically. It's done in silence, and it's not chit-chatting and drinking coffee. It's kind of showing some respect for the environment in which they work. And then throughout the day, there will be yoga, mindfulness, balancing sessions, some run by Corey, some run by outsiders, all sorts of things. And it's, again, entirely voluntary. At lunchtime, they have a head of well-being. In a company of 50 people, they have a well-being manager. And her name's Mary. And she makes a home-cooked vegetarian lunch every day, which, by the way, if you're in East London, is definitely worth turning up for. It's fantastic. She also makes home-baked bread, which is served sort of throughout the day. She has a budget, a daily budget, where she's allowed to buy flowers or concert tickets or an away weekend or whatever it is to kind of just cheer everybody up. They will do, on Friday afternoons, they have a Friday Hack Cafe, which has lots of things to it. So they do the Rolly University. So anybody who feels you know, excited about sharing something about that's not to do with Rolly necessarily, but, you know, something that they're passionate about, they can give a talk of 2 minutes or 2 hours, whatever it is, on a Friday afternoon. They also do this work swap thing, and they found that incredibly productive, where, you know, individuals from the hardware team will work on the software side, and the musicians will, and they sort of cross-pollinate. And it's again, entirely voluntary, kind of fluid cross-pollination, but it works beautifully, and they love it. And then the really interesting thing, and assisted by Felicia Huppert from Cambridge University, they've come up with this work at Rolly Index, and they've only just you know, instituted this, so it's all very, very new. But if Soren's nice enough to invite me next year, I'll give you some time series. We'll sort of plot it. And what they're trying to do is sort of, this is a weekly thing that is, it's designed to be no more than 1 minute to complete it, so it's not a burden. It's anonymous. And it's designed just to give them a kind of a sort of a temperature of, you know, how the you know, how the team is feeling. Can you read it all from back there? Yeah. So I don't need to go through it. So, but I love the notion that, again, you know, helped by Felicia, who's very good at structuring these kind of things, they're trying to measure this, and then they're going to plot it against announcing, you know, the fact that we're shipping the new keyboard, or we've raised a new round of funding, or whatever it is. And, you know, do we noticeable, we see notable blips and a cadence in the Rolly Index. I think these guys are really doing some fascinating stuff. The very essence of what the company does is interesting. And then the people that they've attracted to it, unsurprisingly probably, are pretty extraordinary too. So here we are sitting in Google. Have you all heard of the Search Inside Yourself program? Can I have a show of hands? I don't bore everybody if everybody... Okay, so most of you have heard about it. I think it's... actually, a confession, I'm an angel investor for about 5 more days, and then on Monday next week, I'm joining Google to be a partner at Google Ventures in Europe. So I'm about to go through some of this myself. And thank you. Thank you. Thanks. So I hope to go through some of this as well. So it's if you've read the book or if you've ever heard Meng give one of his brilliant talks, this stuff is great. It starts with some attention training, you know, self-knowledge, self-mastery, and developing very helpful mental habits. It's really interesting hearing him talk about how to get to gain traction in a originally pretty engineering-driven culture like Google, where you're combining neuroscience and mindfulness, which he does brilliantly. But then he found that it was adding this third piece, emotional intelligence, if you remember that from the 2 or 3 slides back, that was when it really found you know, flow within the Google environment, apparently. So linking neuroscience and mindfulness to emotional intelligence, well, what does that mean in a workplace context? Well, it increases performance, it improves leadership, and it creates happy places to work. It was this link with emotional intelligence that proved, and maybe some of the Google people can tell us about if you've been on this or been close to it. I'd love to know, you know, how that feels from sort of the inside. But I think this is still I mean, it's a big initiative now. I just think it's such an exciting initiative done at scale in a big company. Has anybody read Nassim Nicholas Taleb, so Black Swan, and then he wrote this book called Anti-Fragile? Right, so not so many. So maybe the reason for bringing it up here is I think my experience is that entrepreneurs are anti-fragile individuals, and they are brilliant at building anti-fragile organizations. And what does that mean? I've kind of given it away by showing the headline here, but Nassim starts with the book by saying, what is the opposite of fragile? And most people would say, resilience, robust. But all that really means is it can withstand volatility. And he was saying, no, we need something more, which is, what is it that positively flourishes, blossoms with volatility? And hence he came up with, he said, it doesn't exist. That's why we've got to have a new word, which is anti-fragile. And it really is about this flourishing with volatility, and volatility can be stresses or risk or uncertainty in the environment. And, recognizing that volatility is information, and that's a good thing, it's to be cherished. Options trading about 400 years ago, I was a banker in Japan, I ran a small trading room there, and we traded options. And the value of an option is positively correlated with the amount of volatility in whatever it is, Japanese government bonds or the yen currency or the dollar currency. And therefore, these are financial instruments that positively flourish with more volatility. So it's actually an incredibly helpful model for a way of thinking. And entrepreneurs think in options. They think about creating options now, multiple options, so that we'll try this. If it doesn't quite work, then we'll try that. And if we don't do that, then we'll go in through the window. And that's how they, that's how they think. There are a bunch of sort of correlates of all of this. A barbell strategy, he talks about. He said, really, it's sort of the stuff in the middle, the predictable kind of stuff in the middle, and this is his black swan thinking as well. Stay away from that. It's either, pursue either end. We can come back to this if you're interested in this. Look for asymmetries and exploit asymmetries, and that's what entrepreneurs are brilliant at doing. Again, we can come back to... I could geek out on this for a long time. I think he's an incredibly interesting guy. There are more initiatives. The one at the top, I'm really glad Chris and Tessa are here. And Sarah's here as well somewhere, I think. And they, I hope, are going to talk to us about the Mindfulness Initiative. And part of the Mindfulness Initiative in the UK is something that Tessa and Sarah are heading up, which is a mindful workplace stream. And we've got Roland from Roly involved, and we've got a bunch of these people involved. I think that's just so interesting. And even the conversations, so it's pretty early in this process, but the conversations we've had in the room, and by the way, the room here is Chris's office, which is the House of Parliament, which is quite a swanky room. We've had really tremendously interesting, stimulating conversations already, so that a lot of interesting stuff is going to come out of this. Anthony Seldon is probably not here. I think he's speaking tomorrow, and he is awesome. So make sure you go listen to him. He is the headmaster of Wellington College. Actually, he's Sir Anthony Seldon. He has an initiative called Education for Entrepreneurs. Wellington College is one of the top independent schools in the UK, and also helps lead a bunch of the public schools, public in our sense, schools. And they also pioneered a well-being course, primarily for 14 to 16-year-olds, and very, closely aligned with the mindfulness in school stuff. It's a really, really interesting course. It's just sort of one of those world-class innovations in education. And he's now steering that towards the question that I posed earlier on the supply side of entrepreneurship, which is how do we use the education system and tools and techniques from education to embolden more young people and older people to pursue a more entrepreneurial path through life? And, he is just one of the leading thinkers in the world on that stuff. Excited to listen to him tomorrow. Barbara Sahakian is a professor at Cambridge as well. And a very good friend and a very, very, very thoughtful person. And she's done this analysis, which made it to Forbes magazine 3-4 years ago. And it was an analysis of entrepreneurs versus managers. And their differing views in risk tolerance versus risk mitigation, especially around what she calls these hot decisions, which are decisions made in the face of risk that have some emotional content. And she found that, you know, very statistical significant differences between entrepreneurs who accept that there is risk out there and they tolerate it and, you know, work around it. Whereas the rest of us probably spend all our time trying to mitigate the risk and, you know, and that's not what entrepreneurs do. They sort of can flow with risk. It's risk tolerance rather than mitigation. Headspace, how many people use Headspace? Again, that's a third of the audience. Now, they have a product called Headspace for Teams, which they've started to deploy into some quite big organizations, actually including the Treasury in the UK, so George Osborne's team, and big companies, Goldman Sachs uses it. And it's very, very early in the deployment of Headspace for Teams, and those of you who use the app know what it does. But 37% of the teams use it on at least a weekly basis. So, and they're starting to generate some pretty interesting data. So again, if Soren lets me come back in a year's time, I can give you some data on that. Plasticity Labs, doing something that sounds quite, you know, similar. Is Rohan here with Budify? I can't see. If he is, I think he's speaking later today. He has an app called Budify, which again, I think, has a different perspective on all this. Really, really interesting, very exciting stuff. And one more that I heard of last weekend, I was in at a big tech conference in Stockholm, and one of the big venture capital companies there, Northzone, has teamed up with the Stockholm School of Economics and the Karolinska Institute to create two things. One is a bunch of, again, daily yoga and meditation sessions that are available to all entrepreneurs who are part of something called SUP 46, which is a big co-working space in Stockholm. And they're also doing this fairly big, over 18 months, and involving 100 entrepreneurs. They're creating this sort of mindfulness, 8-week mindfulness program. So all of them will do 8 weeks, but spread out over 18 months. And then again, monitoring it and helping them take it back into their respective entrepreneurial organizations and, you know, bedding it in. So, I mean, just as a casual observer of this stuff, what I can see is that, you know, there are so many of these very, very exciting, very interesting, you know, green shoots of initiatives sort of cropping up all over the place with some tremendously talented people behind them and helping shape them, both from the neuroscience side, but the, you know, entrepreneurs as well. And I just wanted to bring it to your attention. And if we've got time for some questions, it sounds like we have. I've got this green thing that I'm going to throw at people. And I would love to hear any questions you've got, if you have any. But I would also love to hear about any initiatives that you might have heard of that I haven't. I'm all ears. Okay. That was an easy throw, huh?
Can you hear me? Yes, great. As an investor, I have a question because typically...
I didn't bring my wallet. It's sort of, yeah.
No, yeah. That's not what I would be asking. Yeah. But it's typically, it's about the return on investment or some other ratio that investors are looking for. And I just wonder whether you have upgraded your software as an investor and look for some other aspects apart from financial return when you're making investments?
It's a great question, right? So, you know, ultimately, and I think that's where the hard, soft kind of language comes from, right? So angel investors or venture capitalists want to return on their capital. That's how the whole thing works. Even those nice people at Google, for whom I'm going to work next week, apparently want some return on their investment. So I'm quite mindful of that. My belief is that, you know, the best way to get a great return on your investment is to help entrepreneurs to develop these soft skills so they can, if you like, unlock the upside of being an entrepreneur, the vision and clarity and creativity, but also protect against the downside. So ability to manage stress and anxiety, which will inevitably happen. As an entrepreneur, you're told no 1,000 times. Get out of my office. You're an idiot. I know I've been there. I mean, on the receiving end of that, not the giving end of that. And it's, you know, so helping entrepreneurs to deal with that, I think, is the only way that you're, you know, likely to do that. I'm not sure that it's necessarily going to be venture capital companies that are the best providers of the soft skills, but I would hope it is. And actually, the really good venture capitalists I know do exactly that. But I think it's part of the ROI. It's not something sort of separate. Unless you, of course. Yeah, right behind you. So you can do the throwing.
There
you
go. Hi there.
Hi.
I was just wondering, given all this inspiration that you have found out there, what 3 things will you implement when you are now hired and become ahead of something? What three things would you...
That's a great question. So it's kind of... I don't know, I mean, at least half of you put your hand up when I asked about who is a meditation and mindfulness practitioner in the room. I am, have been for about 20 years, and I'm not super public about that. I don't really want to, you know, unless people are interested, I don't really want to stand up and, you know, talk about it. I think it's a personal journey, which I'm very happy to share if sharing's well. So it's not about being kind of preachy about you should go and sit in a cave and meditate if you're an entrepreneur. It is about... What I've done so far, and I hope I will continue to do, is I'm a big believer in the cross-pollination of bringing the neuroscientists like Mark Williams and Felicia Huppert into the room with the brilliant people at Entrepreneur First and kind of stepping out of the way. I'm neither a neuroscientist nor a Buddhist, I think my role is just to help make it happen and put them in the same room and then kind of check in, and if it works, then do it again, and if it doesn't work, then maybe tweak it or don't do it again. So that's the role, trying to be an enabler rather than kind of a crusader or a preacher or a, you know, that was only one thing, but I hope it was several things wrapped into one. Yeah, too. Any other questions? Oh, do you want to, sorry to deprive you of the fun of doing this, but, oh, that was a terrible throw, I'm sorry.
I'm Niamh, and Niamh Gunn. I've been driving a national conversation here in Ireland for the last year on creating a wellbeing centre for the country. Yeah. And I'm really interested in the approach you're talking about entrepreneurs, because I was an entrepreneur with the previous business, and I had a big bang about 3 years ago. And for about 10 years, I was going at an adrenaline and a pace that was so fast that there is no possible way I would have heard anyone talking about mindfulness or slowing down and the importance of it, because we were on such an adrenaline and a fast pace and our growth was so fast. And for the last year, I've been trying to have conversations with entrepreneurs, because over the last couple of years, this new world that I've uncovered around the power of slowing down and being mindful, and that impact in work and what you can achieve is so much bigger coming from that place, mm-hmm. has been pretty amazing, and I've seen the effects. But I'm finding it very challenging in trying to communicate that to other entrepreneurs, you know, to talk about this, you know, this better way, this approach. I'm kind of interested that you make it sound so easy.
Thank you.
I think it's around the language, though, and how are you letting entrepreneurs that are going at that fast pace hear you? So I'd be interested.
So I think that's a great question. And so all I've actually done, I think, is put people in touch with each other. Because I think, you know, what tends to happen in a situation like this is potentially reinventing the wheel. And I don't think I've got anything particular to bring to it, except that I have, I've come across the Entrepreneur First people and introduced them to Mark Williams. I've introduced Mark to Roland. Introduce Roland to Chris and Tessa and Sarah on the mindfulness initiative. So just making, I think at some level, it's utterly pragmatic. It's just sort of saying, look, there are some talented people doing this. There are some talented people. Why don't they talk? And I've found that actually is utterly pragmatic, but it actually is probably the most helpful thing at this point. And I'm a big believer in, and I'm not a neuroscientist, I'm a total neophyte, but I'm a big believer in the fact that the advances in the neuroscience over the last 5 to 10 years in particular, and the, you know, fMRI scans, just means that the conversation now can be much kind of harder, if you like, or if the audience requires that harder language around it, with some data-driven, metrics-driven stuff. Whereas before, it might have sounded less hard. Now, probably in this room, that would have worked. But in a lot of rooms that I find myself in, I think that having Mark Williams, if you've all come across Mark Williams or read his book or anything, he's actually a very good friend and an incredible inspiration. And he is just so good at delivering those messages as a neuroscientist. And I think that, you know, that helps enormously. It just sort of frames it in a rather different way. Hope that helps. Any other questions or one down here? Do you mind doing the do a whole lot better than that? Oh my goodness! Oh my word!
Can you hear me?
All right. Yes.
It's more of a, I don't know. I'm just reflecting on your talk. I kind of recognize myself. I'm an entrepreneur myself, part of the Stockholm tech scene, and just in respect to implementing this to people that are, you know, stressed and exactly what you're describing. I found myself doing exactly that for 6 years running my company and then just like totally disconnected from creativity and just stuck in a rut. But actually took a break and I took a sabbatical, even though, you know, Swedes take, what, 8 weeks of vacation. I still did that and we worked 40 weeks a week. But I still found myself, you know, consumed by everything. And that period of time that I took off was actually the most creative time in my entire life. I mean, both for myself, but work-wise as well, which is quite interesting. I just find it funny how, especially entrepreneurs or anyone with a creative type, you know, purpose in life, which I think goes for anyone basically, just go from 25 to 65 and then you retire. And that's when you're supposed to, you know, take a breath. I just think that's, what's your thought on that?
Yeah, they're completely right. They're sort of, and I guess everybody's appetite and need for, you know, getting off the grid is, I guess, personal and, you know, but I mean, we all need that. And it would really help me if you talked to Google about that before I join next week. I'd appreciate that. Anybody else? Somebody at the back so I can test my throwing skill. Oh, there are some at the back. I tell you what, if I throw it to you, would you say your thing?
I work in education and run a network of 77 schools in Ireland, and we're trying to address the moral and ethical needs and shared values for a diverse world in our schools. And I was just listening to the way in which you use the word entrepreneur. Because I don't believe any child is born to be as an entrepreneur. And we all, in education, we use huge numbers of words to segment and limit the expectations and aspirations of young people. And I certainly think that the way in which we talk about entrepreneurs can be quite exclusive and limits the infinite potential of many children.
I think that's a point very well made. And when I talk about when I talk about entrepreneurs, it's everything I've talked about here, I think any human being, young or old, would benefit from a better ability to manage stress and anxiety or be more resilient. You know, I'm just sort of applying it to the little world that, you know, I know and understand. But I think the point you make is very, very well made. And I think actually you'll hear Anthony Seldon tomorrow, I hope, talk about many things, but education for entrepreneurs as well. And we've talked about this, and we don't want to be exclusive, you know, in any way exclude people from that conversation who don't think of themselves as entrepreneurs. And it's very fascinating. I do something called Speakers for Schools in London, and there's another one called Founders for Schools, which I've done. And so I go into schools and talk and tell my story. Entrepreneurs, I was a terrible entrepreneur, by the way. I should have said that right at the beginning. And the kids are just fascinated by it. And very often they haven't even been told entrepreneurial stories or been given sort of entrepreneurial narratives that sort of resonate with them. They may not have come across that in their own families or their own sort of locale. So you're right. I think there's a lot of work to be done to encourage people to think entrepreneurially. We could call it creatively. We could call it a whole bunch of other things. But I think you're absolutely right to point out there's a kind of discourse analysis around that. It says 00 here. It's a time for one of the people at the back who never get to ask a question. Or
right on my left.
It's gone. There you are.
It's interesting. So I come from a family of entrepreneurs, but I work in the corporate world. And your talk resonated with me because of, you know, replace entrepreneurs with, you know, leaders or people who are trying to create vision and lead an organization who have a lot of stress. So from your perspective, you know, we've talked about the Googles of the world and we've talked about entrepreneurs. What can the average industry do, the mediocre organization do to be able to increase mindfulness within their space, I guess?
I think that's an awesome question. It's sort of, I've referred to these entrepreneurial organizations because I'm familiar with them. I would hope that most organizations see themselves at some level as entrepreneurial organizations. If they're not, that would be a, you know, crying shame. I don't think any of this applies exclusively to high growth internet, googly or Google 15 years ago kind of companies. I would hope that, and you know, there are people in the room who know a lot more about this than I do, but these kind of programs, the kind of things that Rolly is trying to do in a 50-person company, can be writ large somehow in Goldman Sachs and Legal & General and bigger organizations out there. I don't think this is exclusively the domain of, you know, high growth entrepreneurial companies. That would just be a sad conclusion if that were true. I think I'd better obey the 000 thing that's going to. Thank you.